Welcome to a new episode of The Brand Called You. Today I have as my guest a very, very dear friend, a very accomplished advertising professional, Arvind Bable. Arvind, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Arvind is from St. Stephen's College. He's from Delhi School of Economics and IIM Ahmedabad. He worked with JWT and then he was CEO of FCB Ulka in Delhi, Singapore, and continues as a board member. Arvind has worked on some of the biggest brands. He's a coach like me, and he's currently associated with the WWF, Urban Advocacy Task Force, and the Population Foundation of India. Arvind, tell us a little bit about your early life, some of your learnings and your challenges.
Well, early life means, IIM happened, for me after doing my schooling in Mayo, then St. Stephen's Economics, and then MA at D School. Then the choice was to grow abroad or to be here. So obviously the attraction of going to the US was great. Mm-hmm. But as destiny plays its hand, it turned out that before I could go, I got admission in Urbana-Champaign. But then I suddenly appeared for an IIM exam out of the blue. Mm-hmm. And got through.
Wonderful.
To my surprise. And so it became IIM. And at Ahmedabad, it was sort of an absolutely phenomenally different experience, a mm-hmm. lot of pressure, which you don't experience in college. But it was probably one of the best times.
And you chose to go into advertising immediately after your MBA.
Yeah, which was destiny again. Mm. Because while my heart said advertising, the mind was saying, let's do sales marketing before one gets into advertising. That mm-hmm. seems to be the traditional wisdom, which was there even then. But as it so happened, my first two offers were from advertising agencies. Mm-hmm. First one from Lintas and next one from JWT, now those days HTA.
Yeah.
And we had a norm that you can't refuse the second offer.
Okay.
So I had already refused one. I couldn't refuse the second. So, well, destiny plays its hand, but I have no regrets. Mm. I sort of went with my heart and I've loved every moment of it. Mm.
So, I've spent time in marketing and running companies, but I've never been an advertising man. And the only thing that fascinates me or gives me a little understanding of advertising is this famous serial Mad Men.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
How much of advertising used to be like what Mad Men is?
I wish.
Nothing like that at all. Whiskey in the office and parties.
No, it was. Mm-hmm. Okay. But these are stories I have heard. Mm-hmm. I probably saw the last of it.
Okay.
Of people who had been through that kind of advertising were there still.
Yeah.
And one heard stories from them about what it was all about. So a lot of that was there, and obviously some measure. But by the time I joined, it had started changing. Okay, so it was a different business. I mean, a lot of the excitements you see in Mad Men and the client relationships, the creative part, the interrelationship between creative and everyone else and clients still existed. Mm. The fun part still existed. Mm. But a lot of the edgy part of Mad Men
But yet when I was with ITC, I remember one of the most legendary advertising managers of ITC, Kokun Mukherjee.
Yes,
was such a good friend. I mean, I think everyone used to envy his life because one, ITC was a big advertiser.
Right.
And he was always out meeting some very interesting people.
Right.
How has advertising started to change over the last two, three decades that you have been associated with?
So, I think I joined in the late 70s. Okay. So, it had already started changing. I think the real change came, I would say, in the late 80s, early 90s. But there was a change happening even during that period. Clients were certainly a lot more, you needed to be a lot more accountable. The consumer economy hadn't kicked in. It would kick in much later, I think, in the late 80s, early 90s, when the economy opened up. But there was a change in advertising in the sense of a lot of Indian brands at that time were coming into the fray, mm-hmm. into advertising.
And which were some of these big ones?
So, you know, all the big family companies had by then realized that they needed to get into marketing rather than just live in the license raj and the selling period of earlier. So whether it was the Shriram Group or it was the Escorts or it was in the Thapar Group or the whole lot of people and organizations, say like Amul, had just about started merging at that point in time. Okay, so while earlier advertising used to be the preserve, a large multinational brands, the Levers and the Colgates and the Palmolive or Ponds, etc. There was a change happening.
Okay.
And I think they needed a different kind of an agency and different relationships with the agency. So it was a partnership which was somewhat different than the traditional advertising you know, relationships which exist.
Okay. Very interesting. And you know, it's often said that when there is a downturn, the first place where most businesses cut back is advertising. Now, you are sitting on the other side, and India has been through several downturns.
Right.
How did you handle some of these challenges that would suddenly hit you for no fault of yours?
Yeah, but in an agency, the vulnerability is a lot more than downturns, as you know. I mean, it's sort of, and more so in the recent years. But, you know, which is why if I were to relate my the Ulka experience more than, I mean, even the JWT experience to that extent, I think one needed to be an agency which was economically viable. Okay. Because a lot of agencies fell by the side.
And brother, I'm assuming profitable, isn't it?
Yes, profitable. A lot of agencies got carried away with the whole, the sheer creative context, the creating the atmosphere within the agency with clients and what we were talking about, Mad Men, the whining and the dining, etc., which is good. But I think, at least from my experience, both at JWT and at Ulka, apart from being great, you know, creativity, brand building kind of places, there was a certain bottom line which had to be kept in mind. You had to keep your costs in control. Because otherwise, yes, you got hit. And a lot of agencies depended on one or two big clients. So if that client wasn't doing well or the industry is not doing well, you would get hit. So the mortality was high for certain kinds of agencies. Fortunately, JWT, where I joined, was a large agency with good, stable relationships. And mostly large consumer product companies, as FMCGs, etc., continue to carry on advertising. I mean, they're not just put the switch off.
Okay.
So I think you had to be sensible about, that's the only way. And if you were not, well, God help you, it was kaput and business closed.
I agree. So, you know, from an advertising man's perspective, your medium has been changing or has been evolving. You know, there's a newspaper, then came the radio, then came television, now radio is back again. And now the complete explosion of handheld devices and digital media. How are agencies adapting to this incredible change?
Well, in my view, they've taken time adapting. My view, the larger agencies, in fact, were slower to adapt. Okay. As it always happens, organizations which have a large stake, which happens to every dominant player in every industry, is the slowest to respond.
Correct.
It's the challenger brands who come in and do it much quicker. Two, I think by the time digital came in, and which is what you'll recognize today, the disaggregation of this one-stop shop had already taken place. Maybe in the around the 2000s or you know, somewhere then, 20, 25 years back, where in the original time, at least when I joined the agency was a one-stop shop.
Correct.
As you would know, for anything you would go to your agency. Whether it is certainly strategy and creative, or it's media planning, or media placement, or it's doing exhibitions, or it's organizing a dealer conference, or
the agency was
the one-stop shop.
Everywhere,
Okay. But that had changed, you know, by the time digital really arrived. So media had got separated. There were specialized event companies. There were specialized, you know, brand consultancies. So the whole digital internet boom and social media boom, as you call it, when it came, agencies were looking into it, had some people looking into it. But in my view, the people who did a lot of work were smaller agencies which started with a lot of young people. And even today, many of them have emerged out of, some of them out of big agencies as separate entities or independent entities. So I think the disaggregation is what has happened. So agencies have adapted in different ways. They've bought out some of these small agencies, many in many cases. Some have branched out as satellites to create digital agencies. So the agency per se is not this one behemoth which handles everything today.
Correct, correct.
Okay. So I don't know if it answers your question, no, but that's the response.
It does. It does. Of what's happening. That's an interesting segue into my next question, you know, and that is that this entire social media is now taking a very, very large chunk of the advertising dollar, or the advertising rupee.
Right.
And there's a lot of linkages directly between the social media company and the client.
Right.
How is that affecting advertising agencies?
Well, the good news is the chunk is big, but not that large.
I see.
Let's be very clear. Still, and I'm talking about more India. I'm not talking about internationally. Depending on the industry and the organization, people are moving increasingly to using social media over a period of time. But I dare say I don't have the latest numbers, but a large chunk still goes into television and print.
Okay.
That's number one. Coming to the next question which you have is in terms of the media agencies themselves becoming creative agencies. I mean, a lot of people who go to Google, Google would do the whatever the advertising is required. You don't have to go to your agency.
Correct.
Okay. And to that extent, I think the agencies, but I've said because of this disaggregation, agencies still get a large chunk of their money. And I'm, you know, so agency is the wrong word to use because this is the mainline agencies, what I'm talking about. Still from a lot of traditional media. Okay, so if you take any big client, there's still a lot of print advertising, there's still a lot of television, because the penetration of television in this country is still very, very deep. Yeah. And if you see even urban households, while there's a move to the newer forms, are still watching a lot of television.
Right? Very true.
So that continues.
Very true. Yeah. So let me now move on and ask you a question for so many of our young entrepreneurs who watch the show. There is this little mystique about what can I as a young entrepreneur with a new brand do with an agency? What is the kind of role that I as a young entrepreneur can hope to seek from an advertising agency to build my brand?
Okay,
probably means holding my hand right through my journey.
Yes and no. Because the form of the agency has changed. So you need to be, as a young entrepreneur, any young entrepreneur, that would be my advice. The trap is to fall for who's the hottest creative shop in town.
Okay.
Which a lot of people do. As it so happens in my career, there was a time, I remember there was an Economist list of the top 10 social stock digital companies, whether it was Make My Trip or Snapdeal or whatever, or Naukri.com. And it was very interesting to see that we were handling from Ulka, when I was here, almost four of them out of the top 10. This ability to burn money and do something exciting and interesting is a great attraction. But that can only work if the entrepreneur is very clear about his or her strategy and very clear about the positioning of the company and the brand they're trying to create. Now, positioning and strategy seem to be very old-fashioned words sometimes to these people. Okay, the theme seems to be, let's just burn money, let more and more people go out, so I need cut-through advertising. So I think that trap has to be avoided. You need to be very clear of what is the organization you're building up, what's your differentiator, how are you going to execute it, and where the differentiation can be. It may not be in the positioning or the idea, it can be in the execution, in the delivery. Now, if you're clear about that, so I'm saying you should choose an agency which provides you that strategic thinking before you leap into looking for just great creative. Okay.
It should not be an ego boost for the promoter.
Yeah, it's just not that, oh, my advertising is fantastic and everyone's loving it and talking about it. Yeah, certainly, it gets them something. It gets them eyeballs, which is very good. But in the long run, to build a successful company, you need to have your positioning and your direction right.
Correct.
Just eyeballs is not going to make you a success.
Correct. I agree.
Yeah.
So, a couple of more questions on advertising before we move to the next stage. One is that, how vibrant is the advertising industry today? Are you getting a lot of young people coming in like it used to be the most preferred place to work in?
I dare say no.
No. Okay.
Okay. See, advertising, once again, I keep coming back to that. You have to disaggregate what you mean by advertising because it's a lot of things.
I know, now. Many things. Right,
so a lot of people are coming, but to the mainline agencies, I think, like for everyone else in this country, I think one of the big issues why we have a great demographic dividend in this country of young people, I'm sorry to say we lack talent. Now, where that comes from, one can spend a whole session, hours discussing. Whether it's our education system, whether it's our mindset to work, whether it's our work ethics, it's our discipline. So you're not going to go into that. So there is a talent scarcity of getting good people. The only one benchmark, and again, because of my view of advertising is of a certain kind, maybe distinct from a lot of other people. And in case we get a chance, we'll talk about Ulka and how we built up and positioning wise. I remember when I joined advertising, we used to go to the IIMs to recruit. I used to go to IIM Ahmedabad, which is my alma mater, to recruit people. And I have recruited people who worked with me who are from the top business schools.
Okay.
I went there, then many years later, it continued. Today, no one from IIM Ahmedabad, agencies don't go. Now, there are multiple reasons. One, the opportunities for young people are a lot more, which are as exciting, whether you take technology or you take social media or telecom. They were newer industries and hence exciting. They were not the typical brick and mortar industry. Two, the ability to pay of the agencies to get the best talent,
correct,
because the expectations today have gone up in terms of salaries, is not there.
Okay. So coming to my last question, which is what you just referred to, and I was going to ask you the same question that, you know, you built Ulka into a very, very major powerhouse. What were the steps you took over the years in this journey to make it what it is today?
Okay, those are fundamental differences. I think when some of us joined the agency, we had all came from, in a way, very similar backgrounds. Ulka was a great startup, a boutique agency in the 60s. Grew phenomenally, especially what we were talking about earlier, with a lot of, it was an Indian agency, and hence grew with a lot of Indian clients.
Right.
So the early clients of Ulka and did a phenomenal job. It became a hot agency in the country. In fact, when I was a client, I chose Ulka as my agency.
Okay.
So that was the first phase of Ulka, the first 20 years of Ulka, from the maybe the 60s to 20, 25 years, till mid-85s. Which was the time when the earlier people who started the agency started moving out, then fatigue had happened, people were leaving, when a new lot came. Now that new lot was a very unique lot. There were five of us who came in, led by person I worked with, Anil Kapoor, whom you know.
I know.
All of us were from one of the IIMs. All of us had worked initial years in advertising.
Mm-hmm.
All of us had worked as clients
okay.
after that.
Mm-hmm.
And then we were coming to Ulka.
Mm-hmm.
So we were very aware of both from what we wanted to do for the agency when we took over Ulka from the previous team. And two, from a distinct positioning point of view.
Mm-hmm.
We felt a lot of clients needed a marketing brand partner rather than just a creative partner.
Okay.
So one, Ulka was positioned very clearly as a provider of brand solutions
mm-hmm.
rather than a provider of creative campaigns. So that was the first distinction.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
To the extent that we used to tell clients, because clients, when they give you a presentation, expected you to come with a creative campaign.
Mm-hmm.
We used to say, sorry, no creative campaign. We're going to come with a strategy first,
mm-hmm.
including, in many cases, product strategy, marketing strategy, distribution strategy, if we had enough time and availability of information from clients
mm-hmm.
to comment on those. Because all of us were marketing people
mm-hmm.
who had worked in marketing agencies, who had had large agencies as their agencies.
Correct.
So that was a very distinct positioning for an agency.
Mm-hmm.
Most agencies don't work like that. So we were not necessarily counted as the most creative agency in the country. But the point is, we didn't want to be that.
Mm.
We wanted to be an agency which made the needle move.
Correct.
And over the 20, 25 years,
mm.
I think that was the distinct identity of Ulka as an agency. It was a consultancy, it was a brand consultancy, it was a marketing consultancy, and
mm.
we also did creative campaigns.
Amazing.
But we did campaigns which made a difference to the client's market share or whatever else
mm-hmm.
your marketing objectives
mm-hmm.
were. So I think that was one key distinction.
Yeah.
The second, if I may mention, was to build a very distinct and unique culture
mm-hmm.
Of an organization. It was an antithesis to a lot of what agencies stood for,
true.
Especially the Mad Men kind
yeah.
of agencies
yeah.
you talked about. And this was not a philosophy which was sort of written on boardroom walls or whatever in the agencies. In fact, I'm in the process of putting it down for the first time in writing.
Oh, wonderful.
But this is what we practiced.
That's a new book coming out?
Well, unlike you, it's a, I don't know, maybe
okay.
the first one is a tough one, but...
Yeah.
So I'm working at something, the working title being the Ulka way, like the McKinsey way. Because it is the culture and value system of the organization
mm-hmm.
which I think made Ulka both distinctive
mm-hmm.
and successful.
Wonderful. So, wonderful. Terrific. So now moving on to a few more questions. But before I get into that, you know, you and I are of a similar vintage. And a question that I ask a lot of people, like you mm. and me, is that after 60,
mm-hmm.
And in India, people don't like to talk
about
the so-called superannuation.
Right. But
it's a reality.
Right.
And yet, given today's health, most of us will probably have 30, 35 years ahead
sure.
of us,
sure.
which means our life post 60
right.
will be almost as long as our working life.
Absolutely.
Very few people prepare
mm-hmm.
for
that.
That stage.
Absolutely.
You've done it well, and I see how well you've transitioned. What would be your thoughts for people of who are reaching similar age, and when should they start planning?
Okay, so there's no, can't be prescriptive about
correct.
It because each to their
absolutely.
Own, and it's very difficult to do that. I can only share what I did, and there's some learning out of that. In my case, at least at Ulka, we decided that we all retire at 58.
Mm-hmm.
But the original idea was that we are not going to necessarily continue. We will be associated with the agency, but not in the operating capacity. The idea being, as an organization, one of our biggest strengths was stability.
Mm-hmm.
The same team headed Ulka for 25 years,
wow.
right? Which was a great strength,
mm-hmm.
But we also recognize at point in time that it was a weakness because we were not then letting younger people come up. So what was the aspiration? If these guys are going to hang around for time immemorial, then why else? The good news was that our second line and third line were also had a vintage of between 12 to 15 years, which was a great show, which was unusual. So idea was to for this top team to move out and start playing an advisor, mentor, coach role and move on, you know, in that phase. And then as and when everyone wished they would move out. So that was one. So I think we were all, when we were at Ulka, we were prepared for...
The institution prepared you for this.
Yeah. As a group, we, value system wise, we said we want to move out from the operating positions and move on. And which is why, while I retired in 2011, I was associated with the organization until 2015. Which was the time I think we decided that the agency needed change. We needed to pass on and we got someone else new into the organization and we all moved up. So in a way, mentally, I was clear that I was going to move on. So that was one. The other thing is for myself, and each of our colleagues have done differently in the organization, there were five of us. Like a good advertising man, there are two things which sort of sorted out my life. One is, I would like to meet people I want to meet. I don't want to meet anyone I need to meet.
Correct.
Okay. So which sort of sorted out saying, so I will not do consultancy, I will not do this, because in all of that, I would have to go to people whom I knew.
Correct.
My clients, people I'd worked with and say, I've started this, can I work with you? So that was need to meet. So I said,
absolutely. Out.
So now people meet people whom I want to meet. The other thing which was driving me very strongly was the fact, and this is a lovely advertising line, which I remember, which a way motivated me, which triggered this thought, which was, when was the last time you did something for the first time?
Yeah.
Okay.
And what is your response to that?
So I realized that, you know, pretty much if you stay in the business, if at all, advertising gives you opportunities to do different things. You don't do the same campaign again, but it's still more of the same. It's the same client relationships. It's the same, you know, talent seeking. It's the motivation. You know, it's the same business, even though it's changed a lot. And I said, I want to do something different. And which is what was my second motivator. The third part, which is you ask, what should people do to prepare? I think one needs to be willing to live with yourself without the label, the designations, the infrastructure of an organization to define your identity.
That's very well said.
Okay. So your identity has to be you. And I think ultimately all of us has to live with ourselves.
Correct.
So you have to prepare yourself to be able to live without these add-on support systems and crutches, if I may use the word, and being severe on that. Okay.
Very well said.
You do miss it. But I think if you can, that, because ultimately the biggest doyens of the industry or the world, who remembers you 5 years later? They remember the person they meet, the individual they got to know well, or they spent time with. The biggest names in the advertising business today are no more talked about. There's someone new name. So you can't keep sticking on to that. So this identity issue is a big issue. And that is a very personal, deep thing. So you have to sort that
out. I agree with you. So Arun, my last question to you. And I've asked this from all my guests because a lot of people who hear us believe that successful people have no failures. So my question to you is, what has been your learning from some of your failures, or learnings from some of your failures?
Oh, this huge. In fact, you know, if you're in a place like an agency, every account loss is a huge failure.
Correct.
Right? And I think early on in my career, I realized that either, and I know people in the agency business who used to go into huge depressions and you know, all kinds of things when they would lose business or would lose a pitch or whatever. And this is something a lot of my team people keep telling me, saying, why doesn't it bother you? I said, of course it bothers me. When you lose, it bothers you. But you have to accept that failure is a part of life. And especially in the business I was in, it was even a greater part of life. Sometimes you felt it was all very unfair for you to lose the business you have because the clients had changed, the new marketing director had come or the new CEO had come and he just didn't like what you did or whatever and you moved. So the acceptance of failure as a part of life is one very critical. Two, now this everyone has said it, so something new. Learning from it is very, very critical. Okay, and the last thing is, in my case, one thing I keep telling a lot of young people, they keep coming to you, a lot of people come to me, I don't like my boss. I don't think he has anything to teach me, which is why I want to move on. I've learned as much from great bosses, which I've I'm blessed to have had all my life. But I've also learned from bosses who are not very good.
Right.
And in fact, sometimes more.
True.
Okay.
True.
So these good and bad experiences is a part of life and you have to take it in the stride. And you have to tell yourself, even this shall pass.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Life is not a regular continuum. There's ups and downs. And if you have that larger philosophical perspective, I believe you come out of failures much better.
I agree with you. So Arvind, thank you very much. It's been an absolute pleasure to have you on our
thank
show.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very
lovely.
Much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for listening to the Brand Called You podcast. Be sure to visit tbcy.in to join the conversation, access show notes, and discover fantastic bonus content. You can follow us on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Simply search for The Brand Called You. Thank you, and see you next week.